Great. Welcome everyone to the second day of WOLA 2020. We have a sequence of talks. The first talk is a spotlight talk by Lisa Zauerman. She's currently a Zego assistant professor at Stanford University on her way to the IAS, and then she will join the faculty at MIT the following year. To give her time for her talk. I won't tell you all the great accomplishments she's had so far. And I'd just like to thank Lisa for giving this talk. Lisa?
Thank you very much, Jacob, for the introduction. And thank you very much to all the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. So my topic is arithmetic cycle removal lemmas and applications in property testing. So let's start with some basics about property testing, and we focus on property testing on Boolean functions in this talk. So let F be a fixed family of Boolean functions from F2 to the n to 0, 1. So each of these functions goes from F2 to the n for some n to 0, 1. And so the 0, 1 we don't interpret as F2 just because we won't really use any kind of algebraic structure on it. Instead, we can think of such a function as the same way as a subset of F2 to the n, where the subset would be all the vectors that are mapped to 1. So this is the way we want to think about such a Boolean function in this talk. And so let me start right away with an example for such a family, which will play an important role in this talk. So we say that a function f from F2 to the n to 0, 1 contains a triangle if there are three vectors x, y, and z, so that their sum is 0, so x plus y plus z equals 0, and they are all mapped to 1. So such a thing we call a triangle. And now we say that a function is triangle free if it does not contain any triangle. And now a family that we can consider is the family of all triangle free functions. And so this is just an example to keep in mind for what's gonna be said soon in this talk. Okay, and so another important point is that if we have any such family of Boolean functions, we can equally interpret that as a property of Boolean functions, where the family consists of all the functions that have this property. So for example, in this example, we consider the property of being triangle free. And so F kind of is the family of triangle free functions, which is the same thing as the property, describes the same thing as the property of being triangle free. And so now, very roughly speaking, property testing is concerned with randomized algorithms that, roughly speaking, decide whether some input function f is part of the family f. So that means whether some input function has the desired property. So let's get a little bit more concrete. So again, f is our fixed family of Boolean functions describing some property. For example, the property of triangle freeness we saw on the last slide. And then a property testing algorithm, which is also called a tester, is supposed to only make a limited number of possibly randomized queries to some function from F2 to the n to 0, 1. And the aim is to, at least roughly speaking, we'll get more concrete quickly, to decide whether this function f has this property. Okay, but the point here is we don't get to know the whole function f to decide this, otherwise it would be trivial. The point is we can only make a limited number of queries to this function f, and we're allowed to do this in an adaptive and randomized way. Okay, so here's a caveat. If we query this function f only at a few places, then it is clearly very hard to distinguish this function f from some other function f prime, which is very close to f. So if f and f prime, if these two functions are very close in the sense that they only differ at very few places, then if we only query a limited number of places, most likely we won't see the difference between the two. So to make this a little bit more formal, let's make the following definition. We say that two functions f and f prime are epsilon far from each other if we have that f of x differs from f prime of x for at least epsilon times 2 to the n input vectors x. So these functions are called epsilon var if for at least an epsilon fraction of these input vectors, the functions differ. And now we say a function f is epsilon far from our property f, or family of functions f, if it's epsilon far from all functions f prime having this property. And so the point here is, if we have two functions f and f prime, which are very close to each other, but f prime has the property and f doesn't, then it's very hard for our tester. So, I mean, our tester basically can't detect that, because if we can only make a limited number of queries, we most likely won't find the few places where f and f prime differ. And so, therefore, we kind of can't be as strict. So instead, what we demand of the tester is that it should, with reasonably high probability, output yes if f does have the property, and that it should output no with reasonably high probability if f is epsilon far from having the property. So the point here is, if f doesn't have the property, but it's very, very close to having it, we can't demand a tester to detect that. So that means the tester is allowed to behave in any way if f doesn't have the property, but is very close to it. Okay, so let's make this definition more precise. So this was just the motivation why this, why we need this whole epsilon far setup here. So f is again our fixed family of Boolean functions, and epsilon is between 0 and 1, some parameter we use to describe how far we want to be. And so now a tester, and this is the formal definition, is an algorithm which is allowed to make randomized queries to this function f from f2 to the n to 0, 1, and which is supposed to output yes with probability at least 2/3 if f has the property, and it's supposed to output no with probability at least 2/3 if f is epsilon far from having the property. So that's what we call a tester. And I just want to stress again that the queries are allowed to be randomized and also adaptive. And so a slight modification of this definition is what's called a one-sided tester. So a one-sided tester is a tester which actually always outputs yes if f has the property. So it outputs yes with probability 1 if f has the property. So basically, a one-sided tester is a more strict version where in this first case, we demand probability 1 here instead of 2/3. And so that's called one-sided, so it's called a tester with one-sided error, or for short, a one-sided tester, because we basically only allow to make an error in one of the two cases. Okay, and so now, given this family F, the central or acentral question property testing is, what's the minimum query complexity that such a tester needs, right? Because we want to do this by making as few as possible queries to the function f. And in particular, there's the following definition. We call the property f strongly testable if the query complexity is only a function of epsilon and not of n. Okay, so if kind of how many queries you need only depends on this parameter epsilon and not on the dimension n of the space f2 to the n here. So that's what we call strongly tested.
Lisa, there's a question from Clement Kanin. Are the results discussed here crucially relying on the Hamming distance uniform distribution, or can they be generalized to other measures, for example, product distributions over f2 to the n?
Well, so I guess so far we didn't actually discuss any results yet, so that was only definitions. So the results that will be discussed later in the talk mostly crucially rely on the Hamming distance, but I think it would be an interesting question to explore these sorts of directions also for other notions of distances. Okay. Okay. So here's again a slightly more condensed version of the definition. So the tester is the algorithm which is supposed to output yes with high probability if f has the property, and no with high probability if f is epsilon far from having the property. And the property is called strongly testable if we can do this with query complexity only depending on epsilon. So now let me make some short historical remarks. So property testing was first initiated by Rubinfeld in Sudan, who kind of came up with this notion of a tester. Goldreich, Goldwasser, and Ron in 1998 started studying property testing for graphs, and then there was a long line of research, which I can't kind of all mention on this one slide, which kind of studied property testing for graphs. And it's now fairly well understood. And in particular, Alon, Fisher, Newman, and Shapira in 2006 gave a characterization of which graph properties are strongly testable. Kaufmann in Sudan in 2008 wrote a very important paper studying property testing of algebraic properties, and they in particular focused on so-called linear invariant linear properties. And so there's also been much more research on algebraic property testing. And so in particular, I want to point out that yesterday we heard a short talk about this. So that was by Jonathan Tidor. And this was about a result, which is a characterization of those linear invariant properties that are strongly testable by a non-adaptive one-sided tester. So here they kind of, so this characterization was suggested by Bhattacharya, Grigorescu, and Shapira, who proved one direction of the characterization, and then Tito and Zhao proved the other direction very recently. But so this, I want to stress, is only for non-adaptive testers, this characterization, whereas in this talk, the testers are all allowed to be adaptive. Okay, so so that was a little bit about the history. So let's go back to this example of triangle freeness to see a kind of to see an example of how a tester for this property can work. So F is the property of triangle freeness, which means not having three vectors x, y, and z in F2 to the n with x plus y plus z equals zero, and all of these being sent to one. So now here is a simple algorithm for testing this property, and this algorithm is actually called the canonical tester because it's so canonical and simple. So the first step is, in your head, without actually querying, you consider the set of all triples which could potentially be triangles. So all triples x, y, z for vectors x, y, z in F2 to the n summing to zero. And now what we do is we choose m independent random triples among the set for some suitably chosen relatively large number m. And then for each of those randomly chosen triples, we query the function at x, I, y, I, and z, I. So now if we find such an some I for which we have f of x, I equals f of y, I equals f of z, I equals 1, then clearly x, I, y, I, z, I form a triangle, right? Because we have x, I plus y, I plus z, I equals 0 for every I. So that means if there's an I so that all these three things are set to 1, then the function f does contain a triangle, so we want the tester to output no. So, otherwise, if we don't find such an I, we let our tester output yes. So that's how the canonical tester works. And so observe that if f is indeed triangle free, so if f has the property of being triangle free, then the output is always yes, because we can never be in this first case. So that's good, but the other thing we would like is that if f is epsilon far from triangle free, so epsilon far from this property f, then we need the output to be no with probability at least 2/3. So so that's not at all obvious whether that holds. But intuitively, it's kind of clear that the output is likely to be no if f contains a lot of triangles, right? Because if our function f has a lot of such triples, then it's reasonably likely that when we choose the m independent ones, we'll discover one of them, okay? So the question now basically becomes, if a function f is epsilon far from being truly completely triangle free, does it mean that the function has to contain many triangles? So, and that's not at all obvious. And in fact, it was proved by Green in 2005, and who proved something slightly more general, which we see later, but in particular, it implies the following thing, that for every epsilon, there exists some delta, just depending on epsilon, so that the following holds, basically what we wanted on the last slide, namely if a function f is epsilon far from being triangle free, it contains at least delta times 2 to the 2n triangles. And so why do we have 2 to the 2n here? Well, 2 to the 2n is the total number of triples that could be triangles. So the total number of triples x, y, z with x plus y plus d equals 0. And so basically, Green's theorem here says, if the function f is epsilon far from being triangle free, then at least a delta fraction of all those triples are indeed triangles. So now let's see why Green's theorem implies that the canonical tester indeed works and is indeed kind of satisfies our conditions to a tester. So suppose, so we already saw that if f is triangle free, the output is always yes. So what we need to check is that if f is epsilon far from triangle free, with probability at least 2/3, the output will be no. So suppose f is epsilon far from triangle free, then by Green's theorem, there are at least a delta fraction of all these triples are triangles. So that means that in each of the m steps where we choose one of these random triples, the canonical tester has a probability of at least delta of discovering one of the triangles. And because these steps are all independent, the total probability that we don't find any triangle is at most 1 minus delta to the m, right? Because in each step we have a probability of 1 minus delta of winning. So it's at most 1 minus delta to the m, which is at most e to the minus delta m, which is at most 1/3 if we choose m to be suitably large, namely of order 1 over delta. Okay, so that means that indeed the canonical tester outputs no with probability at least 2/3 as desired if m is of order 1 over delta. So here's again Green's theorem, and as we just saw on the last slide, this means that the canonical tester works. So this means that testing triangle freeness is strongly testable with where the query complexity only depends on epsilon. And as we also saw on the last slide, the query complexity will be an order 1 over delta. But so now basically, so that's great, it's strongly testable, but now one would also like to know, well, how large is the query complexity actually? So how big is this basically 1 over delta? So if one looks into Green's proofs, the value of delta he gives for this theorem to be true is tiny. So in other words, 1 over delta is gigantic. In fact, 1 over delta grows like a tower of twos of height polynomial in 1 over epsilon. So that means 1 over delta is 2 to the 2 to the and so on to the 2 to the 2 to the, where the height is polynomial in 1 over epsilon. So this means this delta is absolutely tiny and the 1 over delta is gigantic in terms of epsilon. It depends only on epsilon, so it's strongly testable, but it's a huge query complexity. So that's just the value of delta that Green's proof gives. So that doesn't exclude the possibility that in fact there's a better delta. So the question then becomes, what's the best possible delta in Green's theorem above? And this is basically the question, answering this question would answer what kind of is the real query complexity that we need for the canonical tester for testing triangle freeness. Okay, so in this talk, I actually want to talk about not just testing triangle freeness, but testing what's called k-cycle freeness. So triangle freeness is nice, but we can also study other nice properties. And so one property I want to focus on in this talk is called k-cycle freeness. So it's very similar. It's a generalization of triangle freeness. So we say that a function f contains a k-cycle if there are vectors x1 to xk summing to 0, so x1 plus and so on plus xk is 0, and all these map vectors are mapped to 1 by the function. And so this is kind of the same thing as a triangle, just with a larger k. So for k equals 3, this is exactly what we defined earlier as a triangle. And now we say that a function f is k-cycle free if it does not contain a k-cycle, and so one property we are very interested in this talk is the property of being k-cycle free. So f would be the family of all k-cycle free functions. And as I just mentioned, for k equals 3, this is exactly triangle freeness. One can, of course, also ask other things. So what happens if we don't just take the single equation x1 plus and so on plus xk equals 0, but what happens if we replace this by a whole system of linear equations? So that's a good question too. Okay, so for K-cycle freeness, actually Green's theorem wasn't just for triangles. He actually proved something more general. So he proved it actually for K-cycle freeness for all K. So Green proved that for every K at least 3 and every epsilon, there exists a delta, which depends only on K and epsilon, so that the following holds: whenever a function f is epsilon far from being K-cycle free, it contains at least delta times 2 to the k minus 1 times n different k cycles. Okay, and then the same way as we saw earlier for triangles, this also again implies that the canonical tester works for testing k-cycle freeness, and the query complexity will be again of order 1 over delta for the delta here in this theorem of Green. And so in particular, Green's theorem implies that k-cycle freeness is strongly testable. However, again, also in kind of this more general result, kind of the proof that Green gives a value of delta where 1 over delta grows in this terrible way. So it grows like a tower of twos of height polynomial in 1 over epsilon. And so now another remark, so concerning the question on the last slide, what happens if we don't take just one equation but a whole linear system of equations? Kalsira and Wiener and independently Shapira extended Green's result also to that setting. So they proved kind of that even if you take a system of linear equations, mx equals 0, then testing for solutions for that is still strongly testable. Okay, so you might now ask, well, okay, so far we only talked about the canonical tester, so well, that's a bit of a boring tester. Maybe there's much better testers. But actually, Bhattacharya and Xi proved that whenever you're in the setup with kind of the system of equations, and so in particular, that would apply for case like the freeness where you just have one equation, if you consider the property of being free of solutions to the system, also in particular being k-cycle free, then for such a property, the minimum possible query complexity for any one-sided tester is polynomially related to the minimum possible query complexity of the canonical tester. And so that means, at least as long as you're willing to restrict yourself to one-sided testers, it really suffices to study the canonical tester up to a polynomial loss in query complexity. So that means if you really want to find the query complexity of the best one-sided tester, it really suffices to study the canonical tester. And so, so in other words, in order to understand the best possible query complexity for any one-sided tester for testing k-cycle freeness, it essentially suffices to understand the query complexity of the canonical tester. And we saw earlier that the query complexity of the canonical tester for testing k-cycle freeness is of order 1 over delta, where delta is the best possible parameter in Green's result, which depends on epsilon and k. So really kind of the question of what's the best possible query complexity for any one-sided tester for testing k-cycle freeness now just boils down to finding out what's the best possible delta in Green's result. So in theory, I mean, a priori, these two questions may not seem so related, but I hope I now convinced you that really the question we need to study here is, given epsilon, what's the best possible delta we can take in Green's result? And so for the rest of the talk, I'd like to just focus on, so this was kind of the connection of all of this to property testing. And so for the rest of the talk, I want to switch the language a little bit. So here's actually Green's result in the language that he formulated it in, which was not the property testing language. And it says essentially the same thing. It's just a little bit more convenient to work with when analyzing this delta epsilon dependence. So, so there are two differences in which the result here differs from what we said earlier. So one difference is that it's not phrased in terms of functions, but in terms of sets. But we already saw earlier that that's essentially the same thing. And the other difference is that this is kind of a version where we have k different sets, which would correspond to a property testing of function tuples, which one can also consider, just for simplicity, I didn't introduce that. But the setup is essentially, I mean, the bounds are essentially the same, whether you consider tuples of functions or just one single function. So there's reductions to go between them. And so that means it's really kind of still the same thing. So, okay, so what's the statement here? So the statement is for all k at least three and every epsilon, so for every k and every epsilon, there exists a delta, so that for any subsets x1 to xk of f2 to the n, at least one of the following holds. Either the number of k tuples x1 to xk across these sets satisfying x1 plus and so on plus xk equals zero is at least delta times 2 to the k minus 1 times n. So this is the case corresponding to having at least delta times 2 to the k minus 1 n k cycles that we saw earlier. Or we can delete less than epsilon times 2 to the n elements from each of the sets x1 to xk so that no such k tuples remain. So this would be the case which corresponds to earlier our function actually being epsilon close to being k cycle free. So here we can change it by epsilon and get a k cycle free setup. Okay, so this is how this is basically still the same thing as we did before, as we talked about before, but from the mathematical perspective, this sort of formulation is a bit easier to work with. So Green actually proved this for general abelian groups and not just for F2 to the n, but in this talk we stick to F2 to the n. And Green's motivation for proving this were actually very similar removals lemmas in graph theory. So as far as I know, he was not so much motivated from the property testing side of things. Green's proof was based on Fourier analysis, but later Kasera and Wiener found an alternative proof which deduces the statement from graph theoretic removal lemmas. Okay, so here's again the statement, but don't worry about the complicated thing here. It's basically still what I told you earlier. As we saw earlier, the query complexity of the canonical tester for testing k-cycle freeness is of order 1 over delta for the best possible, so the maximum possible delta one can take in the statement above. And so really the question then, as we pointed out earlier, becomes for given k and epsilon, what's the best possible delta we can take in Green's arithmetic k-cycle removal lemma, so in the statement here. And so in particular, one very tempting question to ask is, if k is fixed, can one actually take delta to be polynomial in epsilon? Because if one can take delta to be polynomial in epsilon, that would mean that we get polynomial query complexity for the property testing side of things, for testing k-cycle freeness, which would be very nice. And I think it was, most people assume that would be impossible to take delta to be polynomial in epsilon. I forgot to say one more thing. Yeah, so Green's original proof, 1 over delta grows like, as we said earlier, grows like a tower of 2 of height polynomial in 1 over epsilon. But then Fox improved this to 1 over delta being a tower of 2 of height logarithmic in 1 over epsilon. So that's much better than this, but it's still a gigantic function. It's still a tower type function. So the tower height is now just logarithmic in 1 over epsilon. And so I should also mention that both of these results are valid for arbitrary abelian groups instead of F2 to the n, and the second result actually even for non-abelian groups. Okay, but so as I said earlier, most people I think thought that it wouldn't be possible to take a polynomial bound. Even Green kind of phrased it like that in one of his papers. But then Fox and Lovast proved in 2017 that for k equals 3, so for testing triangle freeness, one can actually take delta to be polynomial in epsilon. And so I think this result came as a surprise, at least to many people. So they proved that for k equals 3, one can take delta to be epsilon to the C3 for some constant C3 in Green's arithmetic three cycles or triangle removal lemma for G equals F2 to the n. And so here the value of this exponent C3 is given by this slightly ugly looking term, and that's roughly 13.239. And interestingly, this exponent is even sharp due to an earlier construction of Wu and Kleinberg. I should also mention that the result of Fox and Lovas holds more generally for fp to the n for any fixed prime p instead of just f2 to the n, but then you get a different exponent depending on p. And the proof of this at the time, very surprising result of Fox and Lovas combines the so-called tricolored sum free theorem, which was actually just proved a few weeks earlier than their paper came out, with a probabilistic subspace sampling argument. So on the next slide, let me tell you a little bit, so for time reasons, we can't go too much into detail, but let me tell you a little bit about this tricolored sum free theorem, which then Fox and Lovas combined in a very clever way with the probabilistic subspace sampling argument. So this tricolored sum free theorem is a slightly odd looking statement, but so in short, it says, if we have triples x1, y1, z1, and so on, to xm, ym, zm of vectors in F2, so that each of these triples sums to zero. So we have xi plus yi plus zi equals zero for every I. And suppose that the number of these triples is at least this thing, so which is roughly 1.890 to the n. Then it is, so if we have many such triples, then it is always possible to choose some indices ijk, which are not all equal, so that we also have xi plus yj plus ck equals zero. So note that we always have this thing if I, j, and k are all equal, right? Because we have this. So if I, j, k are all equal, we always have xi plus yj plus ck equals zero. But the point is that we can also choose indices which are not all equal to get this equation, if m is large enough. And so this statement kind of looks a bit odd maybe, but it's actually a very important statement, and it also has close connections to certain approaches for fast matrix multiplication algorithms. Unfortunately, for time reasons, we can't go into more detail here, but let me mention that so the tricolored sum free theorem, so this theorem, was proved with the arguments of Kotlev and Pach and of Ellenberg and Reisweit from a breakthrough result on the famous cap set problem. So the cap set problem was a very famous problem, and it asks what's the maximum size of a subset of F3 to the n without a three-term arithmetic progression. And so Ellenberg and Reisweit proved that any such set has size at most 2.756 to the n. And so they proved this with a new polynomial method that's due to Kotlev and Pach, and which actually also just appeared a few weeks earlier than Ellenberg and Reisweit's paper. So this was a very exciting time. So first the Kotlev-Pach paper, a few days later, this kind of breakthrough result of Ellenberg and Reisweit. And then Blasiak et al. Noticed that the proof of Ellenberg and Reisweit doesn't just give this, it actually also gives this tricolored sum free theorem. And then again, a few weeks later, Fox and Lovas used this tricolored sum free theorem in combination with a clever subspace sampling argument to prove that one can take delta to be polynomial in epsilon in Green's arithmetic triangle removal lemma. Okay, but that leaves open the question, what happens for larger k? So Fox and Lovas answered the question where we can take delta to be polynomial in epsilon if we have k equals 3, but what about larger k? And so that's a result of Fox, Lovas, and myself, and so we proved that we can also take a polynomial for any larger k. So we proved that for any fixed k at least 3, one can take delta to be polynomial in epsilon, so one can take delta to be epsilon to the ck in Green's arithmetic k-cycle removal lemma for g equals f2 to the n. So here ck is a constant just depending on k. And our proof gives this kind of complicated value for ck, which is roughly linear in k. So it's roughly 12.23 times k minus 2 plus 1. And also our result holds more generally for fp to the n for any fixed point p, but then the exponent will be depending on p2. And so let me also emphasize that this is not just a straightforward generalization of the result of Fox and Lovas for k equals 3. But instead we had to do something new, because the probabilistic sampling argument in the proof of Fox and Lovas for k equals 3 basically doesn't work here. So the reason is that for these k cycles, because they are kind of longer tuples, there can be more complicated dependencies between these k cycles than what is possible to have for k equals 3. And these kind of dependencies basically kind of make the whole probabilistic sampling argument break down. And so instead, we developed a new combinatorial approach to prove this. And so we actually proved the statement by induction on K with the result of Fox and Lovas for K equals 3 as the base case. Yeah, and for time reason, unfortunately, I can't tell you anything more about the proof. But I want to point out that it's, I think, a very interesting and still open problem to figure out what the best exponent CK is one can take here. So for K equals 3, Fox and Lovas had this exponent of 13.23, roughly 13.239, which is sharp. But for larger K, we don't know whether our exponent is sharp. And so in joint work with Lovas, so with Laszlo Miklós Lovas, the same, so I should have mentioned that earlier. So all the Lovas is here refer to Laszlo Miklós Lovas. So in joint work with Laszlo Miklós Lovas, we proved a lower bound for the best possible exponent CK. And if you write it out, it's kind of this horrible looking term. But so that now gives us the bound that the best possible exponent CK, so at most this upper bound that we have in the proof of our theorem that we can take it polynomially, at least this lower bound from my result with Laszlo Miklós Lovas. And so this is not at all obvious by staring at it, I think, but one can check that for large K, these upper and lower bounds differ by a factor of roughly 12. And so I think it's still a very interesting question to figure out what's actually going on and what's the right exponent CK here. Okay, and I'm almost out of time, but let me make some more concluding remarks. So kind of what we proved was that for any fixed K at least 3, one can take delta to be polynomial in epsilon in Green's arithmetic K-cycle removal lemma for G equals F2 to the n. And so as we kind of saw earlier in the first half of the talk, this means that for any fixed K at least 3, the canonical tester can test K-cycle freeness with query complexity polynomial in 1 over query complexity polynomial in 1 over epsilon. I also mentioned earlier that Karl, Serra, and Wehner, and independently Shapira, proved a result about testing for solutions for a linear system of equations. So they proved that if you have a fixed system of linear equations mx equals 0, where m is a matrix, then being free of solutions for this system of equations, so where you kind of, for k-cycles, you just have one equation, x1 plus and so on, plus xk equals 0, but here you have a whole system, so you want to test for being free of solutions for this system with f of x1 equals, and so on, equals f of xk equals 1. So they proved that this is also strongly testable. It's still an open problem whether for this sort of setup with the system of equations, one can also take the query complexity polynomial in epsilon. And I think that would be a very interesting direction of future research to, I mean, maybe kind of proving this for all linear system of equations would be out of reach, but at least for certain linear systems of linear equations where kind of the number of equations is not so big compared to the number of variables, maybe this is kind of, this might actually be possible. And so I think there's still interesting directions for future research here, but I'm out of time, and so I want to thank you for your attention.
Okay, let's thank Lisa. There was a question earlier by Sandeep Silwell asking about whether there could be a bound depending on n. So if epsilon was allowed to go to zero with n quickly, maybe there could be a better trade-off in some regime if epsilon's very small.
Yeah, so I mean, I think it's also interesting to study this in other regimes, but typically in the sort of property testing setup, you kind of have epsilon, I guess, semi-fixed and then n very, very, very large. So kind of the notion of strongly testable is also about only depending on epsilon for any arbitrarily large n. So that's kind of the range of parameters that's typically studied here. But I think it's definitely an interesting question to also consider other parameter ranges.
There's a new questions about further applications to electrical engineering signal processing. Wondering about further applications.
I'm not aware of, so was the question of applications of property testing in general or of the arithmetic cycle removal lemma?
I guess either one. I mean, probably okay. More generally. If
okay, you know. So for the arithmetic cycle removal lemma, I'm not aware of such applications. So it clearly has this connection to property testing. But apart from that, I'm not aware of any other applications outside of, for property testing in general, I can easily imagine there's plenty of applications, but I'm actually more expert on the math side of things, so I'm probably not the right person to ask for applications of property testing in general.
Madhu Sudan asks, any guesses on the setting of general linear systems?
Yeah, so I'm not sure. So my guess is if one wants to attack this sort of question down here, one should start with a setting where the number of equations is strictly less than half of the number of variables. And so the reason for that is that, so I guess we saw that the result of Fox and Lovas for k equals 3 crucially relied on this tricolored sum-free theorem, which came out of this whole new polynomial method development around the CAPSET problem. And so all of these methods, they basically break down if the number of equations is more, at least half of the number of the variables. So basically these new tools, which kind of led to the result of Fox and Lovas, which then later we used in our joint work for larger K. So basically the foundation of that would then all go away. So you would kind of be as stuck as before the whole CAPSET development happened. But if the number of equations is strictly less than half of the number of variables, then the sort of polynomial method side of things all works out. And so that's kind of very nice. The problem though is, I guess I didn't go into super much detail, but so the reason for larger K we needed this new strategy was not because the polynomial method wouldn't work there. So that side of things, so the tricolored sum-free theorem does generalize kind of to larger k instead of k equals 3. So that side of things was really not the problem. The problem was the subspace sampling argument. So that kind of breaks down for larger k because of these dependencies between larger tuples. So kind of, so these sorts of challenges one obviously has, probably even more so if one has a system of equations. So I think this is really an interesting direction, but I think it's best to focus on the case where one at least has the tools with the polynomial method. So that would be the case where the number of equations is less than half the number of variables.
Great. Thank you for your insight. Let's thank so that was our spotlight speaker for this session. Going to be Sit down.